Hey guys, it's Simon and welcome to my new tutorial series for libgdx and Kotlin, where we are going to develop a small game. For those of you who are watching this video for the first time and who don't know me, so my name is Simon, I'm from Austria, this is the way I speak in English, so my native language is German, this is the way I speak English, and if the way I talk annoys you a lot, then please turn off this video, because that's going to happen now for the remaining of this tutorial series. Some of you might know me already from the other tutorial series I did, I think 1 or 2 years ago, I don't remember exactly, where we did something with Java and tried to make a game which was called Mystic Garden. So I showed a little bit how it works. We also used libgdx there. And now we are going to make a completely different game. I show it in a moment, and we use Kotlin instead of Java. So first of all, what are we going to implement, or which game are we going to develop? Let me show it to you. So the game is called, I called it Dark Matter. And it's currently here in German, but we will also support, of course, the English language. So if I would start it from with English language for the JVM, you would see here English text instead of German text. But that's not important. We will learn that throughout the tutorial series. We will develop a main menu where you can control, like for example, if you want to hear the music. So now it's off. Now it's on again. We will store the high score. So how far did the ship go? We will see that in a moment, what that means. So what is the goal of this game? Little bits of the control introduction. So how can you control your ship with how's it called, a scroll pane, if you have a lot of text and people need to scroll. And we will target both platforms for that. So I'm currently running it on the desktop, but this game is also running on the Android phone, and it's actually already available in the Play Store. I will link the link to the Play Store in the video description below. You can check that out if you want. I will also add the GitHub page, because the entire source code is available on GitHub. You can always check that out as well. And yeah, what is the goal of the game? So you are controlling this little ship. You can move from left to right. And when you pay attention to the bottom left, there is a, yeah, I called it a dark matter in this game. So it's slowly sucking in our ship, and the player can collect several power-ups, as you see here. Currently, we collected already a couple of shield power-ups. So our ship here got a little bit of a blue shield around it, so we don't get immediate damage when we get to the dark matter area. We will have a scrolling background, as you see here. If we collect some speed boosts, which bring us to the top, the background is scrolling faster. We can pause the game at any moment. So if you want to have a break or something, you can pause it and you don't get game over. We can resume then, of course. At the bottom, we see here the life. So how many life do we still have with the ship? You see a little bit of the shield. So that's the blue area around the life bar. You see the distance that was traveled and the current speed of the ship. So currently it's -1 because we are getting slowly sucked in. And what happens? So if we get into the dark area, we lose a little bit of shield, and once the shield is gone, we take damage. The shield becomes red and soon will explode. Then it's game over. You will see the distance that was traveled, the high score, so the highest distance that we traveled. You can go back to the main menu, start a new game, or in this case, we will stop it. So this is the game that we are going to develop throughout this series. And if you're interested, then please stay tuned. So first of all, who is this tutorial for? So I expect that you have a little bit of knowledge about Java, and ideally already about Kotlin and maybe libgdx. If you don't have any experience with that, if you are a complete new beginner and you don't know some programming basics, then this tutorial series is not for you, because I will not explain everything, like for example, what is a map, what is a list, what is an integer, what is a string. Those things I will not explain, so I assume that you already know that. If you don't know that, please read some other tutorials or books, and then you can come back to this tutorial if you're interested. If you already have a little bit of knowledge and experience with Kotlin and libgdx, then please stay tuned, because then this tutorial might be perfect for you. Why do we use Kotlin? I learned Kotlin, I think, 2 years ago as well. I looked into it a little bit and I started loving it after a couple of months when I used it, Because in my opinion, it's less verbose than Java. I'm faster with it, and also the code, at least for me, is more readable when I write it the Kotlin way, and also safer, because with the built-in null pointer exceptions, for example, so with the null safety included already into the language, the IDE already warns you about a lot of mistakes that could happen. So that's why we are going to use that, and I guess it's already currently the future if you want to develop anything for Android. And yeah, if it's mainly for desktop, I think you could still stick to Java if you want, but even there I would suggest to use Kotlin nowadays. I just like the language a lot more than Java, and yeah, that's just my personal opinion about that. And of course we are going to use that together with IntelliJ IDE, because that's the IDE and the people behind that which developed Kotlin. So it's JetBrains, and I think in their IDE most likely you get the best support for this language. So that's what we are going to use. And I would not suggest to use Eclipse nowadays, to be honest, here as well. I would propose that you learn to use IntelliJ or Android Studio if you want, but please don't use Eclipse, because I guess especially for Android development, and I assume also for Kotlin development, it's not the best IDE to use for that. If you make something like a rich client platform, then use Eclipse, it's the best IDE out there for that, but for everything else I would not suggest to use it. Then, why are we going to use libgdx? So libgdx has the benefit that we only need to write code once. So we see that also in this part soon. So there's a so-called core project where you have your code for the game, and you can then use it for Android, for desktop, for iOS, for web, so for the browser. And I think it's the best library out there if you want to program on a low level thing. So if you want to just click through a game like Game Maker or something, then I would suggest to go to a different library. But if you want to go a little bit under the hood and learn the low stuff of something, so like how do you render graphics, what is a shader and so on, then I would suggest to use libgdx. And at least for me personally, I find it a lot of fun to develop things there and find out how things are working. And yeah, that's the way why we use it, because we can control almost everything then. We are not limited to this out-of-the-box game maker studio thingies, because with libgdx you can do whatever you want. It depends on your skill what you can do, but in theory you could do everything. And together with libgdx, we're going to use libktx. Those are Kotlin extensions for libgdx, which help us to make the code cleaner, more readable, and also helps us to write certain things in the Kotlin way instead of the normal libgdx Java way, which is also usually a less verbose code than in the end. Okay, for the setup char. So last time in the Mystic Garden tutorial, we used the official libgdx setup, but this time we will use a different setup tool. So we start our browser and it's called gdx liftoff. You can Google that. I will also add the links to the video description below. And why do we use this one? So currently it's an supported and maintained open source project, and it's in my opinion a more modern way to set up your libgdx project, because it uses the latest Gradle version, it uses the lightweight Java game something, what library I think, free backend for the desktop, which is the more modern way to develop desktop applications. You could of course use the standard libgdx setup, which is just using the normal LWJGL, and you could then change it manually to the version 3, but with this setup, it just uses the latest versions of almost everything, and in my opinion it makes a better setup than the current gdx setup jar. Maybe they improve that with one of the versions in the future, but at the moment in May 2020 I would suggest to use gdx liftoff for the setup. Once we have downloaded it, then simply open it. It's very similar to the normal gdx setup jar. So what is the name of our project? I will call this one Dark Matter YouTube, because I already have Dark Matter itself. As a package, I use com, GitHub, Quillraven, Dark Matter. It's always usually the, what I use nowadays is usually always my GitHub account. And there, this is the project actually that I will also link then in the video description. And there you see the entire source code of the game that I showed before. Then what is the name of our game class? So our main entry point of the game. Usually I call it main or game or something. This time we will go with a little different approach. I will call it actually the way the game is called. It's always depends on how I want to call it. The problem, one thing that could be a problem here, if you call it game, like I did it in the past projects, there are several out-of-the-box classes already with libgdx, which have the name game already as well. So you have then the game from libgdx, you have the game that you developed, and then maybe there's another game in the, I don't know, Java classes or something. So you might have here a game clash, and then with the imports, you always need to be careful that you import the correct game class. So that's why coming up with a more unique name would be a better approach here. We stick here with Dark Matter, but you can name it whatever you want. Okay, and then finally we need to choose a folder where we want to save it. For me, that would be my normal development folder and the Git location currently. And the location then to your Android SDK if you want to target Android. So that's controlled here below. So we want to develop for Android. So now this gets available and should locate to the SDK folder of your Android SDK. And we will use the desktop. We don't care about HTML or iOS. We won't cover that in this tutorial. And I don't know what share is. And here would be also the old desktop, as I mentioned before. So instead of the LWJGL3, it would use the old desktop thingy. So I think it's called LWJGL or something. Or 2, okay, it's mentioned here, so it's the version 2 instead of version 3, but we want to target the new one. It's better. Okay, what else do we need to do? Languages. So here you can control what kind of additional things you want to have. And since we want to use Kotlin, we will tick here that we use the Kotlin language. Extensions, there are several out of the box libgdx extensions available, and what we need in this tutorial series is Ashley. We don't care about box2d in this tutorial. We will make it a little bit easier. We covered there a couple of things in the old tutorial series. We won't use AI, bullet, controllers, free type and tools, because especially for tools you can normally just download the tool that you need, and it does not need to be part of your game project, in my opinion. Then there would be also third-party things, like other useful things that are out there. We won't use any of them, but yeah, if you're interested in some of them, you can check them out. Templates, we will use the game template in this case, because then it's a little bit more set up already for a game. Because libgdx can of course also be used for other things, like normal applications, which are not a game, like, I don't know, an image browsing library or whatever, but since we are going to develop a game, we will use the game template for that. And advanced, here we could control a little bit the versions that we want to use, and also how our versions are called for our game. And here I normally never change anything, we just leave it as it is. And if we are done with that, we can then just create it. Okay, we can create it if we go to a correct folder. So this is already available, so we will make a new one. Okay, I think we need to create this folder. Now it's there, and now we can create our project. Setup complete. Okay, so what happened now? Let's check it out, what we created. So we created now a new folder, Dark Matter YouTube, and in there we have now the game setup. And as you can see, since we said we want to have Android, we have the Android backend here. We have the LWJGL3 backend, that's the desktop one. And we have the core project. What that means, we will see that in a moment, because now we are going to import this project into our IDE. So for that, we are going to open IntelliJ. and we are going to open or import our project. And the way we do that is by selecting the main Gradle file, because Gradle is the build tool that is used with libgdx games. And that's why we select here the main build Gradle file, open it, then it will already ask us if we want to open it as a project. Yes, we want to do that. Now it imports it, takes a couple of seconds or minutes depending on your computer power. It's indexing now also all the files. And once that is done, we have then the project available in IDE and we could run it then. So let's wait a couple of seconds. The first time when you import it, it will now download all the dependencies, so that Gradle takes care of that. So it will download now, for example, the libgdx core libraries, the Ashley library that we have selected, anything else that is dependent on that. So all of that will be downloaded. I have most of them already available because I already developed something with version 1.9.10 of libgdx. So for me, it does not take that long. For you, if it's the first time that you use that, it might take a couple of seconds or minutes to download all these jars. Okay, and finally, we want to run it to see if everything was really working. So let's go to our desktop backend for the time being. As mentioned, the setup creates Java classes, but we will convert them to Kotlin in the next part. So here we just try to run it now. And as you can see, so it correctly opens now the window. It has the name of our game, an icon for the window, and I think we can resize it a little bit. And that's it. So nothing really interesting is happening. What is the default setup for that? So to show you what the template, so the game template was doing, it created a game. I will explain that in the next part what that is. And it sets an initial screen. So our first screen, this is this game screen. I call it pattern. I don't know if it's really a pattern, but we will cover that in more detail in the next part. And we have then a screen which is doing actually nothing. So that's why we just have a black background at the moment when we start the game. So everything is correct. So the desktop application is already running and working. And we could also try out the Android one. For the Android one, you either need to connect your phone. You need to Google a little bit how to make it then runnable, that you can deploy things to it. I already did that with my Samsung S8, but I guess it's different for every other phone, so I cannot explain that in more detail. And there you can then also simply run it, so run Android launcher. Then here at the top you see on what kind of phones you could currently run it. So for me it's this G9500, that's my S8. And with that, I would say that's it for the first part. So we were able to import the project into IDE. We were able to run it on the different platforms. And in the next part, we are again really looking into the details with Kotlin, how to convert the launcher classes, how to convert the game to the Kotlin style. And yeah, to make it then a real Kotlin project then in the end, because currently it's still a Java project. And one more thing here that I want to mention, was a nice comment in my opinion in my last series, where someone had a couple of questions. People are usually facing issues when they're trying out on their own, and I give them some hints of course and try to help them. And someone mentioned then that he, because I asked him if he needs the new code or something, or if he needs to share something, and he said no, because he's actually just learning the concepts from my tutorials and he's trying it out in his own project, so completely different one. And I would also suggest that you do the same, because that's also the way I learn it. So usually I have an idea in my head of a game that I want to develop, then I look or read tutorials, and then I use the things that I learned and use it in my own project. So if possible, I would suggest for you as well to not just blindly copy and paste everything that I show here. It's better that you have your own idea and try to use the things that you learn here in your own project. My opinion, that's the better approach to learn something. And at the end, I also want to recommend two or three things. So the first thing, I will also add that to the links in the video description below. That's this website, so Game Programming Patterns. I think if I remember correctly, the code that or the language that is used is actually C or C++. But you learn, in my opinion, a lot of useful things about game development patterns and the concepts behind it. And if you really understand it, then you know how to use it then in other languages. I think that should not be the difference. Some things are already built in libgdx, so you already have that available, like, for example, the game loop pattern or update method pattern. But other things, you can read that through. I find them very useful and interesting to read. So this is actually one page that I want to recommend if you're interested in that. And the second one are books, and there I want to recommend one book, and I want to tell you two books that you should definitely not buy, because they are, one is actually really garbage and the other one is so mediocre, I would say, not that good. So this book here, libgdx cross-platform game development cookbook, this is the one that I want to recommend. It covers, I think, actually all important topics about input handling, graphics, music, sound, and some shader topic. So very advanced topics sometimes. And it always gives you a generic solution for certain problems, so that you can use it in almost all of your games. And in my opinion, it's written very good, in a very good way and understandable. And you can then use that in your own games. I use a couple of things actually also in this tutorial series. And there are some things that I did not try out yet, but that sounded very useful. So if you are interested in libgdx game development, then I would totally recommend this book. That's the good one. Then there is this one that I also bought, libgdx cross-platform development blueprints, and this book is total garbage in my opinion. So I bought it on Pact for I think 5 euros in Christmas time, so it was not a lot of waste of money, but it was still waste of money. So if you see this book and you're thinking to buy it, please don't do it, because the author, in my opinion, has no idea, or he has not a good idea how to develop games. He's using almost none of the best practices, and the way he's explaining things is really, really bad. Sometimes, I think it's actually mentioned, copy the code from here, paste it in here, and use it. That was the explanation in one of the chapters, where I really thought, okay, in a book I would expect that you explain why you're using things and not just tell me to copy and paste it and it will work. This is really a garbage book. I should have never bought it. Don't buy it. And the last one that I want to mention here is Mastering libgdx Game Development. So this is there you are going to develop an RPG, and this is the one where I would say it's medium good. So it covers certain things like entity component systems, inventory system, and so on. So you can develop an RPG like that, but in my opinion, the author again is not using the concepts in a consistent way, because he's explaining things at the beginning, like entity component system is awesome and good and use it, but then in later chapters he's not using it at all and just developing things without the entity component system, which in my opinion does not make sense. And a couple of other things he's not solving in a very good way, in my opinion. So this one, I would say, if you're interested in RPGs, it's okay-ish, but it's not a good book, in my opinion. The better approach would be go through that one, the libgdx cross-platform game development cookbook, and then try to build it up, build it on your own. Okay, but that's enough talking for the first part. I hope it was not too long. Please let me know in the comments below what you think about that. Although I guess in this part there was nothing, a lot of important, interesting things in there. The interesting stuff then starts in the next part. So thanks you for watching, and see you in the next part. Bye bye.